बिस्मिल्लाहिर्रहमानिर्रहीम। टुडेज़ टॉपिक इज नॉन लैंगर हैंड सेल हिस्टोसाइटोसिस एंड इन द लास्ट टॉक आई डिस्कस्ड अबाउट द लैंगर हैंड सेल हिस्टोसाइटोसिस। सो दिस इज द नॉन लैंगर हैंड सेल हिस्टोसाइटोसिस एनकंपासेस अ नंबर ऑफ डिफरेंट डिजीजेस। All of them are actually not. We are going to discuss each and every disease, but I would be brief and short in discussion of these diseases because there are many similarities in their presentations, in their histological appearances, and in the treatment. And in addition to that. Most of the diseases which come under the non-Langerhans histiocytosis are quite rare, and you would hardly come across them in your maybe whole life. But some diseases are important, and even important for exam point of view. So now we are going to start this lecture, and I hope that I am audible to every one of you.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
So the first group is the non-dendritic and non-Langerhans cell histiocytosis. This is a unique group which includes only one disease, and this is hemophagocytic lymphohistiocytosis. So just concentrate on the name there. And I told you in the previous lecture that the histiocytes are of two types. Those histiocytes which perform phagocytosis and those histiocytes which perform antigen presentation. So this group of disease is regarding those histiocytes which are phagocytes. Hemophagocytic means that the histiocytes have ingested RBC, and lymphohistiocytosis means that the primary cells, in addition to histiocytes, are lymphocytes. So it is a reactive histiocytosis in which there is widespread infiltration of multiple organs by lymphocytes and mature histiocytes showing prominent cytophagocytosis. So the name comes in the definition here. There are two types of hemophagocytic lymphohistiocytosis. One is the primary, and the second one is the secondary form, which is also called as the macrophage activation syndrome. It is a rare disease with incidence of 1 into 50,000, but it is rapidly fatal in most patients. That is why it is important here. I have written a lot in the slides, but I have only underlined the important points which you should remember. The cardinal symptoms of hemophagocytic lymphohistiocytosis is high fever, hepatosplenomegaly, and cytopenias. And because of these three symptoms, there will be further pallor, anorexia, vomiting, irritability, and lymphadenopathy. Rash can be there. What is prominent in the lab investigation? Cytopenia. Cytopenia is initially anemia or thrombocytopenia with raised liver enzymes and hyperbilirubinemia, because it causes the main features are fever, fever, hepatosplenomegaly, and cytopenia. So cytopenias are anemia and thrombocytopenia and increased bilirubin and enzymes. Hyperlipidemia is also a feature, and consumption coagulopathy is also seen in this condition. The histopathology will demonstrate hemophagocytosis, especially of erythrocyte but leukocyte. So this is a large histocyte. This is a large histocyte in which you can see 1, 2, and 3 RBCs. These are the red blood cells which are engulfed by the histiocytes. So this phenomena is called as hemophagocytosis. There is quite an extensive diagnostic criteria for hemophagocytic lymphohistiocytosis, and it is established by if one or either one or two of below is fulfilled. The first one is mandatory, that is the molecular diagnosis consistent with hemophagocytic lymphohistiocytosis with other features. I am not going into detail because this will make your life more complicated and miserable. So just remember whatever being taught to you. It is a potentially fatal disease. So that's why the treatment is also comprising of cytotoxic and immunosuppressive drugs. The first line drug in primary hemophagocytic lymphohistiocytosis is dexamethasone, etoposide, and cyclosporine. Alternatively, anti-thymocyte globulin and L-metazumab may be given as a biologic. And in secondary, again, there are combinations of immunosuppressives and chemotherapeutic agents which are used in the treatment of hemophagocytic lymphohistiocytosis. So the second category of non-Langerhans cell histiocytosis will be including those histiocytoses which do not meet the phenotypical criteria of Langerhans cell histiocytosis. And these histiocytoses are further subclassified as dendritic and non-dendritic cell division. For example, the Langerhans cell histiocytosis is seen in Langerhans cells are seen in epidermis, while the dendritic histiocytes, which are the antigen-presenting cells, are present in the dermis. So, in addition to those dendritic histiocytes which are present in the dermis, this group will also include those histiocytes which are non-dendritic. And there are two types of non-Langerhans cell histiocytosis. That which predominantly affect the skin, which include juvenile xanthogranuloma and reticulohistiocytoma, and those which are primarily systemic disease and skin is involved secondarily. This would include Erdem-Chester disease, then Rossi-Doffman disease. So I will be touching all these diseases rather briefly, and so that you should not feel complications and difficulties. Juvenile xanthogranuloma is important because this is not an uncommon disease, and we come across such patients in our OPD and even in the exam. Juvenile xanthogranuloma originates from the dendritic histiocytes which are present in the dermis or dermal dendrocytes. They are benign tumors, predominantly affecting infancy and early childhood and showing spontaneous regression. Half of the cases are reported in infants less than 6 months of age. Lesions may occur in children over 3 years and rarely reported in adults. The histiocytes which are seen in juvenile xanthogranuloma are factor 13A, CD68 positive, while S100 and CD1A are negative. Cuton joint cells are characteristically seen in juvenile xanthogranuloma, which is one of the diagnostic hallmarks of histology. In genetics, there is association of juvenile xanthogranuloma with neurofibromatosis 1. Clinical features, the disease is characterized by single to multiple papules or nodules with predilection for face, head and neck with slight surface telangiectasia, and the consistency is firm to rubbery. There is a variety which is called as joint xanthogranuloma, in which there is a solitary lesion which is more than 2 centimeters in size. So this is a typical juvenile xanthogranuloma in a forehead. Similarly, lesions are seen on the body, groin, trunk, everywhere. Juvenile xanthogranuloma, either cutaneous or systemic, usually follows a benign course with spontaneous resolution of the lesions within 1 to 5 years. CNS can be involved. Hence, whenever you find such a case, a short case, the system you are going to examine is CNS, especially checking the seizures, ataxia, intracranial hypertension, developmental delay, diabetes insipidus. The diagnosis is made by histopathology and immunohistochemistry. So this is an expanded nodule, and it is seen as some mass within the dermis. Epidermis is stretched and thinned out over this mass. The mass is comprising of histocytes, which are showing xanthomatization or engulfment of fat. And these xanthoma cells are always histocytes which have engulfed fat, and many of the histocytosis, they demonstrate xanthoma cells, that is histocytes having fat within the cytoplasm. So xanthogranuloma, as the name signifies, again is characterized by these xanthoma cells. In addition to the xanthoma cells, we see the Teuton type giant cells. This is a Teuton type giant cell, which is having a wreath-like rim of nucleus in the center. The wreath are usually what is made of flowers taken by the dignitaries to the graves. These are actually the wreaths. So the wreath-like arrangement of nuclei in the center and cytoplasm, which is rich in lipids surrounding that wreath-like structure. So this total structure is a Teuton-type giant cell, this total structure. So early lesions of xanthogranulomas comprises of normal histocytes without xanthoma cells, but later on they turn into xanthoma-type histocytes. Immunohistochemistry I have discussed before. No treatment is necessary because it is a self-limiting disease. Sometimes treatment is required if it is present, the nodules are present in the ocular, upper respiratory tract or CNS, which includes surgery, radiotherapy, carbon dioxide laser. Sometimes lesion, aggressive disease with organ involvement is treated by chemotherapy, including cytarabine, methotrexate, vincristine, and prednisolone. Benign cephalic histocytosis is again a related disorder, which can be considered as a clinical variant or mild form of juvenile xanthogranuloma with no systemic involvement. So in juvenile xanthogranuloma, you can have a systemic involvement, especially CNS, but benign cephalic histocytosis, as the name signifies, is quite benign and involves the head and neck region. There can be numerous erythematous macules and papules, which can vary from 1 to 100, and it may extend to trunk and upper limb and occasionally buttock, and then it is self-limiting. Characterized by proliferation of sheets of histocytes with eosinophilic cytoplasm. Xanthomatization here is not present, like in juvenile xanthogranuloma. Then another non-Langerhans cell histocytosis is generalized eruptive histocytoma. Just concentrate on the name. The name explains how the disease is behaving. It is a cutaneous histocytosis affecting adults, characterized by multiple symmetrical papules on which are skin colored brown or blue red. Number of lesions are variable but may reach 100. Asymptomatic and spontaneous resolution. So here, you can, there are multiple erythematous to skin color, yellowish papules or nodules on the face and the trunk. Since it's an eruptive histocytosis, it is characterized by multiple eruptions. Histology, again, occupies the sheets of histocytes, occupy the papillary and upper reticular dermis. Epidermis is normal. These are the histocytes with abundant eosinophilic cytoplasm. Immunohistochemistry is identical to JXG, which is CD68 positive, MAC387, factor 13A, negative for S100 and C1A. No xanthomatization. Self-limiting does not require treatment. Sometimes PUVA may be find effective. Then patients can be treated with chloroquine, thalidomide, and glucocorticoid. Papular xanthoma. Generalized eruptive histocytoma in which there are papules, but these papules, this is the previous disease. These papules were not, these papules were characterized by histocytes which were not showing xanthomatization. But here it is papular xanthoma. It is the first described in adult and subsequently reported in children, is a variant of xanthogranulomas. So papular xanthomas are characterized again by eruption of skin color to erythematous papules on head, neck, trunk, and body. Now the histology is showing, since the name is papular xanthoma, so histology also shows the xanthoma cells. And xanthoma cells are histocytes, they are CD68 and 13, factor 13A positive. Clinically resembles juvenile xanthogranuloma, but is not associated with systemic involvement or caffeolemacules, because it is not associated with neurofibromatosis 1. There is no predilection to flexures. Sometimes the resolution is leaving anitoderma-like scarring. No treatment is required and for children and nor for the adults. Next disease is progressive nodular histocytosis. Just always concentrate on the name. Progressive means it's of progressive nature. It is now not papular, it is nodular and histocytosis. Eruption consists of two different types of lesions, superficial papules and deep nodules, which may number to hundreds. Papules are 2 to 10 mm yellow-orange, nodules are 1 to 5 centimeter skin color. Mucosa may be involved. Histology shows xanthomatized cells and scalloped histocytes with lymphocytic infiltration. Immunohistochemistry is similar in all these conditions, that is CD68 positive, 13A positive, both stains histocytes and S100 and CD1A negative. So now the progressive nodular are different from papular histocytoma because now they are mainly nodules. Then xanthoma disseminatum, as the name signifies, it would look like a xanthoma and would be disseminating, spreading, and involving large areas of body. So characterized by histocyte with lipid deposition, patients are normolipemic, and it is associated with diabetes mellitus. There is erythematous yellow-brown papules or nodules on the trunk going to the limbs. And mucosa involved may result in hoarseness and respiratory embarrassment. So xanthoma disseminatum can, the xanthoma or yellowish orangish color papules can occur everywhere. Face, on scrotum. Early lesions comprising of non-xanthoma histocytes. Later lesions, the xanthoma cells are present. Mitosis may be seen. Giant cells may be seen. Puton type giant cells may be seen. And sometimes the cells are quite spindly and it would give appearance of dermatofibroma or fibrous histiocytoma. And since the immunohistochemistry of dermatofibroma is quite similar to that of these xanthoma, so it is difficult to separate the two conditions. Treatment would be carbon dioxide laser, surgical excision, and for disseminated case, we can go for chemotherapy. Diffuse plain xanthomatosis. It is a rare non-lipemic disease in which xanthomatous lesions develop in skin and associated with paraproteinemias. Just remember that. Adult disease, and it is characterized by sheets of yellow color, sheets of plaques or sheets of xanthomatous skin lesions like hair. Your treatment is that of underlying myeloproliferative of a disease of paraproteins. This is the third category of non-Langerhans cell histiocytosis, in which skin may be involved but systemic component predominates. So these are also reactive diseases, but since they are involving the organs, so they are associated with lots of morbidity and illness. Erdem-Chester disease is a rare lipoid granulomatosis characterized by infiltration of viscera, bones, retroperitoneum, and skin. Huge age range and present with xanthoma-like lesions. Involves almost all the organs like lung, heart, kidney, liver, pituitary, CNS, orbit, skin. Histological examination, since it's a lipomic disease, it is characterized by xanthogranulomatous infiltration, which are CD68 and 13A positive. Overall mortality is high, 15.7%. Since it's a potentially serious disease, we treat it with surgical debulking, high-dose steroids, cyclosporin, interferon, systemic chemotherapy, and radiation therapy. Then another category of Langerhans cell histiocytosis is the non-dendritic histiocytes, which involve mainly the skin with or without systemic component. So two main diseases come in this category. That is reticulohistocytoma and its systemic variety, which is called as the multicentric reticulohistocytosis. Reticulohistocytoma. It is a localized variant of multicentric reticulohistocytosis, usually solitary or asymptomatic. Present as a papule or dome-shaped nodule anywhere on the body. A nodule which is expanded nodule with a stretch epidermis and comprising of sheets of histocytes with number of giant cells and having a ground glass or quite pinkish eosinophilic cytoplasm. The cells are CD68 and 163 positive and S101A negative. Factor 13A is variable in reticulohistocytoma. Treatment is by surgical excision. Multicentric reticulohistocytoma. This disease is important because this disorder comes in the differential diagnosis of diseases characterized by mutilating arthropathy and skin nodules. Other disorders are rheumatoid arthritis and psoriasis. Multi-system disorder characterized by cutaneous and mucosal involvement in addition to destructive arthropathy. And 28% have internal malignancy. Occur in middle-aged or elderly whites And patient present initially as polyarthritis, especially interphalangeal joint, then other joint, big joints like knee, shoulder, wrist, hips, ankle are also involved. And his radiographs show osteolytic lesions. So you can appreciate the mutilating arthropathy involving the distal interphalangeal joint. And characteristic skin nodules and pigmentation. Pruritus is also seen. These are the lesions around the eyes. 15% of patients are associated with autoimmune disorders. Prognosis is good, but disease becomes quiescent 7 to 8 years if there is no associated malignancy. Treatment, no treatment is considered valuable. However, systemic steroids are successful, but for a brief period of time, along with immunosuppressives like azathioprine, NSAIDs usually have no effect on arthropathy. Cyclophosphamide has given a good result, as well as the tumor necrotic factor alpha antagonist. Then, a histocytosis, a systemic histocytosis called as familial C blue histocytosis. It is a rare inherited disorder with lipid abnormalities, and characteristic histocytes are seen in bone marrow and other tissues. Present in young with hepatomegaly and thrombocytopenia. Skin may be involved with brownish gray pigmentation of face, upper chest, and shoulders. Histology, it is characterized by micronodular infiltrates of large monomorphous histocytes with cytoplasmic vacuoles and granules. So these histocytes are studded with cytoplasmic granules or vacuoles. PS stain highlights these granules, and there is another stain which is the GIMSA stain or the May Grunwald stain. Both these stains stain these granules as blue. That is why this disease is called as familial C blue histocytosis. No specific treatment, but treatment of associated lipid abnormalities result in resolution of the disease. Then another disease which you might have heard before, it is called as the melanoplakia. Melanoplakia is a histocytosis which is characterized by immunodeficiency and macrophaging. Immunodeficiency and macrophage are unable to phagocytose and digest bacteria adequately. So it is basically a defect of phagocytosis. So the word melanoplakia means soft plaques, and it is characterized by multiple soft plaques or abscesses, mainly in the flexures and with sinuses and ulcers. And it would come in the differential diagnosis of vegetating pemphigus, of hidradenitis suppurativa. It is a self-limiting but fatal course have been reported. The histologically, it is characterized by histocytes with abundant cytoplasm, and cells have fine eosinophilic granules in their cytoplasm, and these cells are called as Hansmann cells. And these Hansmann cells contain one or more rounded basophilic inclusion bodies. And these inclusion bodies are termed as Michaelis-Gutmann bodies. So these are the histocytes which contain these Michaelis-Gutmann bodies. These histocytes, they are called as von Hansmann, Hansmann's histocytes. Von Hansmann histocytes, and the inclusion bodies are called as Michaelis-Gutmann bodies. These are the soft plaques. These are the Michaelis-Goodman bodies. The commonest bacterium, these Michaelis-Goodman bodies are considered pathognomic of the disease and thought to represent abnormal degradation of bacteria. Since these histocytes, they are poor phagocytes. That's why the bacteria is not digested but transformed into these inclusion bodies or called, which are Michaelis-Goodman bodies. Bacteria which are present here is E. coli, although Staph aureus have been cultured and mycobacteria have been found in some cases. Management is mainly by surgical excision and antibiotics if bacterial infection is suspected. And quinolone seems to be...
Take it out.
Then another systemic histocytosis, which is called as the juvenile xanthogranuloma. Necrobiotic xanthogranuloma. Necrobiotic xanthogranuloma is again a multi-system histocytosis with widespread infiltration of xanthomatous nodules and plaques and hematologically malignant condition. Skin is characterized by nodules and xanthomatous plaques and atrophy. Systemic symptoms, these are the xanthomatous lesions on the eye like xanthelasmas, but these are more characteristic lesions like necrobiosis lipoidica. The lesions are showing necrobiotic xanthogranuloma, demonstrating necrobiosis like we see in lipoid proteinosis with ulceration and yellowish erythematous nodules and plaques. Management is by to treat the paraproteinemias with alkylating agents like melphalan with or without prednisolone. Other therapies include corticosteroids, chlorambucil. So in the treatment of all the systemic histocytosis, you don't have to remember each and every drug separately, but just remember that these are treated by high dose corticosteroids, by different chemotherapeutic agents like the alkylating agents, Venca analog, and by other site immunosuppressive drugs like cyclophosphamide, methotrexate, and azathioprine. Then another systemic histocytosis, which is called as the sinus histocytosis with massive lymphadenopathy. This name signifies that this histocytosis involves the lymph nodes, and it is also known by its name as the Rozier-Dorfman disease. It is a non-neoplastic disorder, self-limiting, characterized by abundant histocytes in lymph nodes throughout the body. Infectious causes like EV virus, Klebsiella, and Brucella have been proposed. Most patients are young, but adult males are also seen, characterized by massive, painless cervical lymphadenopathy with fever, night sweats, and neutropenia. So their disease will simulate Hodgkin's lymphoma. Extranodal deposition occurs, brown-red nodules are seen over different parts of the body. Diffuse swelling of hands may occur. Hyperpigmented plaques are seen. Histology would show a dense multinodular cellular infiltrate, which comprised mainly of histocytes with abundant eosinophilic cytoplasm and lymphocytes. And these histocytes again demonstrate phagocytosis, which is also called as amperipolysis. These are the lymphocytes which are engulfed by the histocyte. This is a histocyte. This whole is a histocyte, and these are the lymphocytes and plasma cells. So the plasma cells, these are the plasma cells, and these are the lymphocytes, which are engulfed by these histocytes. The immunohistochemistry is S100, CD163, alpha chymotrypsin and alpha antitrypsin are negative for CD1A. So the CD68 highlights the histocytes and also highlight the phenomena of emperipolysis or phagocytosis. Prognosis is not that bad. Poor prognostic feature are immunoglobulin abnormality and multiple extranodal site of the disease. Treated by Vinca encologs, cyclosporin, radiotherapy, surgical debulking. Then the last portion of this chapter is histocytosis, malignant histocytosis, or histocytosis with malignant potential. You are just going to remember the conditions 1, 2, 3, 4, which are characterized by malignant histocytosis. So these are all the malignancies of monocyte macrophage series of cells and are separated into monocytic leukemia if it is involving the monocytes which are in the circulation or bone marrow. Malignant histocytosis if the malignancy is of histocytes present in the tissue. Then two histocytic lymphoma involving the lymph node and histocytic sarcoma involving the dermis. In monocytic leukemia, the malignancy primarily affects the bone marrow and blood, but extramedullary involvement is common and classified as a part of myelomonocytic leukemia. Then malignant histocytosis. Histocytes retain the ability to migrate and widespread involvement of reticular endothelial system, that is lymph nodes, liver and spleen. Then histocytic lymphoma, mainly involving the lymph nodes. Then histocytic sarcoma involves mature histocytes and represents highly aggressive disease. So after that, we are not going into the further detail of these conditions, because you will make yourself confused if you will go into the detail. What is leukemia cutis? It is rarely encountered, associated with poor prognosis. It implies the infiltration of ischemia with leukemic white cells, which are erythematous, violaceous papules or nodules. So this, if the skin is involved with leukemia cells, it shows poor prognosis. And this condition is called as the leukemia cutis. So we are not going into the detail of these conditions. So you just remember that there are leukemias, there are histocytic lymphomas, histocytic sarcoma, and malignant histocytosis. So remembering this is more than sufficient. And I'm ending my lecture here. Now, if you have any questions regarding non-Langerhans cell histocytosis, you can ask me here. Sab samajh aa gaya?
Thank you, sir. जी सर, थैंक यू.
हाँ, मतलब देखो, इसमें कोई बहुत ज्यादा कोई कॉन्सेप्चुअल लर्निंग तो थी नहीं, लेकिन जो कॉन्सेप्चुअल लर्निंग है ना, वो मैं आपको समराइज इतनी कर दूं कि हमने वी डिस्कस्ड द मेन टॉपिक ऑफ हिस्टोसाइटोसिस, और मैंने आपको बताया कि हिस्टोसाइट्स आर द सेल्स विच आर ड्राइव फ्रॉम बोन मैरो. जब तक वो ब्लड में होते हैं वो मोनोसाइट कहलाते हैं, जब टिश्यू में आते हैं तो वो हिस्टोसाइट्स बन जाते हैं. टिश्यू में हिस्टोसाइट्स या फैगोसाइटोसिस करते हैं या एंटीजन प्रेजेंटेशन. एंटीजन प्रेजेंटिंग सेल्स दो तरह के होते हैं, एक लैंगरहैंस सेल्स और एक डर्मल डेंड्रोसाइट. लैंगरहैंस सेल हिस्टोसाइटोसिस इज द मोस्ट कॉमन टाइप ऑफ हिस्टोसाइटोसिस, एंड इन दिस चैप्टर यू विल ऑल स्टडी लैंगरहैंस सेल हिस्टोसाइटोसिस कीनली एंड क्लोजली. लेकिन ये भी नहीं कि एक एक लफ्ज पढ़ना है. जो इंपॉर्टेंट पॉइंट्स हैं लैंगरहैंस सेल हिस्टोसाइटोसिस के, कि उसकी कैसी प्रेजेंटेशन है, सिंगल ऑर्गन इन्वॉल्वमेंट, मल्टीसेंट्रिक इन्वॉल्वमेंट, फिर इम्यूनोहिस्टोकेमिस्ट्री कैसी होती है, प्रेजेंटेशन कैसी होती है, और इसके ट्रीटमेंट में क्या इंपॉर्टेंट है। फिर लैंगरहैंस सेल हिस्टोसाइटोसिस के अलावा जो दूसरा कॉन्सेप्ट है वो ये है कि बाकी तमाम हिस्टोसाइटोसिस आर जनरली क्लासिफाइड एज नॉन लैंगरहैंस सेल हिस्टोसाइटोसिस। और जो तीसरी क्लासिफिकेशन है वो है हिस्टोसिटिक ट्यूमर्स। तो जो नॉन लैंगरहैंस हिस्टोसाइटोसिस हैं उनको आप दो तरह से क्लासिफाई कर सकते हैं। एक वो हिस्टोसाइटोसिस की जो प्राइमरीली स्किन को इन्वॉल्व करते हैं, और तमाम वो हिस्टोसाइटोसिस जो स्किन को इन्वॉल्व करते हैं वो सारे बिनाइन हैं और सेल्फ लिमिटिंग हैं, ट्रीटमेंट की जरूरत नहीं। और दूसरे कैटेगरी ऑफ नॉन लैंगरहैंस सेल हिस्टोसाइटोसिस वो हैं कि जहां पे सिस्टेमिक इन्वॉल्वमेंट है, अगरचे वो रिएक्टिव कंडीशंस हैं बट बिकॉज ऑफ सिस्टेमिक इन्वॉल्वमेंट, रेटिकुलो एंडोथेलियल सेल इन्वॉल्वमेंट, दे कॉजेस पोटेंशियली फेटल डिसऑर्डर। और इन तमाम डिसऑर्डर्स में स्किन सेकेंडरीली इन्वॉल्व होती है, और वो तमाम डिसऑर्डर्स के जिसमें स्किन सेकेंडरीली इन्वॉल्व होती है वो उनमें ट्रीटमेंट किया जाता है विद हाई डोज स्टीरॉयड्स, इम्यूनोसप्रेसिव, साइटोटॉक्सिक ड्रग्स। इन सिस्टेमिक कंडीशंस में जो प्रोमिनेंट डिजीजेस हैं वो हैं हीमोफेगोसाइटिक लिम्फोहिस्टोसाइटोसिस, मल्टीसेंट्रिक रेटिकुलोहिस्टोसाइटोसिस, फैमिलियर सी ब्लू हिस्टोसाइटोसिस और रोजाइड डॉफमैन डिजीज। फिर वो नॉन लैंगरहैंस सेल हिस्टोसाइटोसिस कि जिसमें मेनली स्किन इन्वॉल्व होती है उसमें आती हैं वो कंडीशंस जो हम कॉमनली देखते हैं लाइक जुवेनाइल ज़ेंथोग्रैनुलोमा, बेनाइन केफेलिक हिस्टोसाइटोसिस, ज़ेंथोमा डिसेमिनेटम और मुख्तलिफ और ज़ेंथोमास के जिसमें स्किन आइदर ज़ेंथोमेटाइज और नॉन ज़ेंथोमेटाइज सेल्स के साथ ज़ेंथोमेटाइज और नॉन ज़ेंथोमेटाइज सेल्स से इन्फिल्ट्रेट करते हैं। तो ये जो स्किन डिसऑर्डर्स हैं इनमें जो हिस्टोसाइट्स हैं वो या तो प्लेन हिस्टोसाइट्स हैं विदाउट एनी ज़ेंथोमेटाइजेशन और लिपिड ड्रॉपलेट्स या विद ज़ेंथोमेटस ड्रॉपलेट्स। जिन डिसऑर्डर्स में ज़ेंथोमा का लफ्ज आएगा वो ऑब्वियस हो जाएंगे कि उनके अंदर ज़ेंथोमेटाइज सेल्स, और उन कंडीशंस में ट्यूटोन जायंट सेल्स भी आपको देखने को मिले। तो ये हो गया एक बेसिक कॉन्सेप्ट, और मेरे ख्याल है इतना कॉन्सेप्ट आ जाए और लैंगरहैंस सेल हिस्टोसाइटोसिस के बारे में आपको थोड़ा ज्यादा डिटेल मालूम हो तो आई थिंक दिस चैप्टर विल बी ओवर। हिस्टोसाइटोसिस विल बी कमिंग इन एग्जाम मे बी एज इन फॉर्म ऑफ जुवेनाइल ज़ेंथोग्रैनुलोमा, बेनाइन केफेलिक हिस्टोसाइटोसिस और मे बी लैंगरहैंस सेल हिस्टोसाइटोसिस, मे कम इन द हिस्टोपैथोलॉजी और इन द डिफरेंशियल डायग्नोसिस ऑफ मेनी डिफरेंट कंडीशंस जिसका मैंने मेंशन किया। तो इस नोट के बाद साथ अब ये लेक्चर एंड करते हैं। इंशाल्लाह फिर नेक्स्ट लेक्चर जो मैं मैस्टोसाइटोसिस का लूंगा जिसकी डेट मैं आपको बाद में अनाउंस करूंगा, फिर इंशाल्लाह आपसे बात होगी। तो सो लॉन्ग,
थैंक यू सो मच सर,
थैंक यू सर।